in studio in the Wairarapa. And Paul has just re-engineered a piece, it was a robe, and then said, hey, try this on, and he tried it on, and now he's just actually tailored it to fit me. So I'm going to nip into the change room, change, and come out with a full bird original. Ta-da!
Perfect.
Thank you. Paul showed me a dress that he had on the mannequin and said, do you like florals? And I do. So here I am in original Lichtenberg number.
Yeah.
Do you want to talk me through how it arrived originally, what you did with it?
Well, somebody just came in, a local came in and dropped off this, which was a big, long, flowing, bead vintage coat with white lace collar. With this collar.
It's a bit
manic, isn't it? Yeah, so it was very kind of like dated and very old school. But then it was such beautiful fabric that I knew I needed to do something special with it, so I just re-engineered it, put some ribbing in through the neckline and through the kind of like waist area, shortened it and put some ribbing in the back of the dress as well to give it a nice kind of hourglass shape, and just to modernise it. And you know, it's such a nice lightweight fabric that I knew would be perfect for summer.
Yeah.
And I wanted to keep the sleeves in it because I know it's quite important
for women of a certain age.
Yeah.
And that's one of the reasons why I love it, because I'm older now, I don't necessarily want my arms showing, but you also want a little summer dress, and I love the drop on it as well.
Yeah.
And it's relaxed and updated with this tissue.
Yeah, kind of like a bomber jacket. Like I was kind of inspired by like bomber jackets, but in its own remixed version of it. Like I think it's always important if you're going to remix things to have your own take on it, so then it becomes a timeless piece.
Yeah.
So I mean, like, you know, this is going to a forever home. Thank you very much, Bernadette.
And it's a lot more street than what I was wearing.
Yeah, totally. And it's like nice that, you know, you were saying that this isn't a silhouette that you've really played with before. And then, you know, after kind of just doing the tweaks and stuff for you, you know, this will be there for summer.
Yeah. So Paul just took it in a little bit on the sides.
Yeah.
Because I thought it was making me a little bit sort of boxy before. And now I love it. Thank you.
Oh, that's all right. No. Thank you. I mean, like, I love it when my stuff goes to the perfect home. So, no. Thank you. Thank you as well. But, you know, it just makes me so excited to see, you know, like...
And this is what this slow fashion movement is all about. Like, if you've got a beautiful fabric and you can re-engineer it to have that extended life rather than spending someone's wardrobe. But I should introduce you properly first. So this is Paulie Cabert, and I met him earlier this year when he won the Oversoul Awards with an incredible outfit. It just, sometimes you meet someone and they're a really standout designer, and you tell that there was just talent just pouring off you. It was amazing. It was a pleasure to meet you.
Oh, nice
to meet you. And Paul's background, from what I understand, you started out as a graphic designer, and then you took up pattern making, and you worked for the big New Zealand brands like Karen Walker, Miss Crab, etc. And now you've moved into the space of slow fashion and re-engineered fashion.
Yeah, definitely.
Tell me why.
The reason I wanted to kind of go into slow fashion was just seeing the turnaround of fast fashion. It's just scary, and seeing people having their style dictated to them is always a little bit daunting, I guess. I just think it's really nice for people to have their personalities come through fashion and to just feel special, feel beautiful. I mean, you know, like this piece now, and I think it's just important to dress people's personalities, not let clothes take over them, like, you know, take people, like, losing themselves sometimes, so plus to just kind of reclaim yourself and have your own sense of style and, you know, feel confident.
It's a big old trend as well, isn't
it? No, I don't think so. It's kind of one thing that I've never really been a part of, like, you know, but I find something that fits me well and I love it and it's a piece that's going to last forever. Like, I love just wearing things to better end.
Yeah.
And then re-engineering them at the end as well. Like, it's so nice with textiles that it's such a reusable resource and it's just so nice to do something outside of it.
Yeah.
You know, it doesn't need to just end at that, like, you know, was just sitting in somebody's wardrobe, sitting there. Like, they loved it, they brought it into me. Do whatever you want with this, and then, you know, I saw the second life.
Yeah.
So this, and yeah.
So it doesn't stop when that trend is no longer apparent?
No, no. And, like, this isn't, I don't think it's, like I said earlier, it's been remixed in a way that it makes it kind of contemporary and timeless. So, you know, I think that's what's important about slow fashion is not having to just stick to trends. And
so when we were having a coffee just before, we were talking about fabrics. So, like, this is a beautiful fabric, and whether you notice a difference between the fabrics used in fast fashion and the fabrics that are used in design houses or in garments that have been out here, like this one is probably, I don't know, I hate to think how many decades old it is. Yeah, do you, when you were seeing these different pieces come through, are you noticing a difference in quality of the fabric?
Oh, definitely, especially from like the older pieces, which have already stood a couple of decades worth of time, and you know that they're still going to last, versus the really fast fashion stuff that comes through and it's already deteriorating and pilling and all of that kind of stuff, which makes it a lot harder to rework because the quality is so poor and it's, and it doesn't have the kind of like plastic feel that I like as well, with like, you know, beautiful floral prints or nice check shirts and like natural fiber garments, like, yeah, cottons, like, it's always things that I like working with, but the fast fashion stuff that's coming through, it's, it seems like it's only got one life, like it's hard to turn that into a second life.
Lower quality fabrics with a shorter lifespan.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, versus, you know, the older stuff that's already done its dash and can do its dash again.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that comes down to the quality of the yarn, the quality of the production, all those sort of factors that impact on that. It's just got such a tune through that those aspects of it are just not given any regard now. Whereas before you wanted something, you know, people before knew a lot, because there was a lot more home sewing. People knew a lot more about quality of fabrics, and they knew different fabrics and the feel of them and the touch of them and the actual construction and the weave. People knew so much more about fabric construction that it's just been completely lost, I think.
Yeah, definitely. And I think it's like, it had to be quality fabric for people to work with it at home back in the days. So, I mean, like, I don't know what it's like for people working with these really synthetic, poor quality fabric. I mean, like, if I ever have to do like an alteration out of this stuff, like, I find it difficult. So it's just quite sad to know that people have to work with poor quality fabric, trying to produce it in a way that's supposed to be not good, but
yeah.
So you
even see in the, with those poor quality fabrics, sometimes the weaves are so loose that you get this distortion, like when you try, as a pattern maker, trying to lay up a fabric and the fabric's not square.
Oh yeah, like the wefts and the warps.
Mm.
And this is pretty much on a
on an angle.
Yeah, on a skew, and you put your pattern down and it's like, oh, which way do I, am I supposed to go with this grain? Because, you know, it's just warped and stretched out of place. And then at the end of it, when the garment's finished, because it's already got those flaws in it, the overall product has got flaws in it.
Yeah.
So it's not sitting right. It's,
yeah,
it's not sitting right, and you know,
yeah.
It's just sad.
Yeah. So tell me about what encourages you in this space, in the space that you're working in now.
The main thing that encourages me is like my friends and my family and people that are like super supportive and people that have personalities and like for me to dress real human beings instead of these faceless mannequins. Like, you know, human interaction is always so important for me, and for me to connect with people and to do my work via them is just such a beautiful way to, you know, really get my work out there.
So you mean instead of just supplying to your work going on to a rack where you never meet the person who ends up wearing that garment, having your own store, you meet your own customers, and right?
Yeah.
Well, I was saying before, it reminds me of the old school tailors where the tailor would have his workshop and have his store in the same space, and you'd be able to come in and you'd be able to see the tailor working away.
Oh.
That's what your space reminds me of.
Oh, thanks.
Because the machines,
yeah.
And the, yeah.
Got everything there. And it's just, I think it's important for people to connect with how things are being made. Again, to see like the time and effort, because it's like, I think it's quite nice to add value back into things that are deemed like invaluable. So, yeah.
The Ellen MacArthur Foundation report that came out just recently, just in the last couple of weeks, speaks of how many millions of dollars, hundreds of millions of dollars in value that's lost by us just tuning through our clothes and throwing them in the bin, or you set huge value in those resources that are just getting thrown out.
Mm.
Yeah,
that's
and
scary.
It's what you're doing is addressing that that area where people have just gone, oh, it's not on trend anymore, I want to throw it away. And what you're doing, it captures that value that's been lost at the moment.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, just through like contemporary, timeless, classic pieces that can like last more than like one season.
Yeah.
You know, I like it for things to be worked in its own way, like just organically and beautifully out there without having to be just another number. Yeah.
Yeah. Another on the rack of a friend of mine was saying that she had a moment where she felt quite overwhelmed, where she went into a store and she saw all of these garments, and she was looking for one particular garment and she saw all of them and she thought, oh, this is just one store in Christchurch. And then she thought about the other stores in Christchurch carrying the same stock, and then the other stores in New Zealand carrying the same stock, and then the other stores around the world carrying the same stock. And she just said she felt completely overwhelmed by it and walked out.
Oh.
She said, who buys all this? Literally, who buys all this stuff?
Yeah.
And why do we need this constant tune where they're having, you know, multiple seasons every year that designers are having to design to at a really, really rapid rate? It's incredible.
Yeah, pre-fall, fall, pre-summer,
yeah.
Resort, blah blah blah, like all of these collections, and it's just like adding more pressure like on the people that are actually working working in those workrooms and stuff, and then adds more pressure onto the environment from it all just getting like churned out so rapidly, when it's like, can't we just slow it down and just let people decide for themselves? Like, I don't think I'll ever be one of those designers that just rapidly just pumps out, like, you know, I'd rather spend time perfecting something than just rushing it. Because
yeah.
I don't think, and that the more you rush it, the less value it's going to hold at the end of it. So I think it's nice to just put in the effort, put in the time, and really just put that value back into it.
Yeah. I remember when I first started work as a teenager, the first thing my mother did was take me to a tailor's in Wellington and get a winter coat made.
Oh, nice.
So I had a good New Zealand made woolen winter coat fitted to me, and I had it for years and years and years, and it always looked smart, and I was a bit resistant to the idea because I was thinking, oh mum, I don't want a woolen coat, I actually want a bomber jacket. And she's going, no, you're having a woolen coat. And it was absolutely brilliant. It was, and it, you always look smart when
yeah.
you went out, and it fitted so well. And it was a great piece for years and years. And I think it's getting back to that, where you invest in a piece where it just looks great and you're proud to wear it. You know, you
yeah.
don't have to change your coat and have a different coat next year.
No.
Yeah.
No. And if it's just like a timeless classic, you know it's going to keep on going through. Like, it doesn't. Especially, it's always a staple to have a woolen coat.
Yeah.
In your wardrobe. Like, the perfect one. It's better to go for the perfect one in multiples.
Yeah.
And so just that whole actually investing your money instead of just wasting your money in multiples. Investing it in one piece that you know is going to last. And that fits you beautifully. And that, you know, is always going to... It's always going to carry you back. Always going to be there for you, you know.
Yeah.
Those ones, those pieces that you always your trusty reliables. It's a matter of yeah, like I've got all my trusty reliables, no, which I've had for years, and
yeah.
they're always there.
Yeah, and the and sometimes are a reasonable investment, but then that investment pays off because you're not wanting to discard it for the next season's.
Yeah.
For the next year's winter range, you know, the winter coat, yeah, or the winter whatever, or the, yeah.
And then sometimes I think with like fast fashion and stuff, like if you've got something on and then you see somebody else wearing it, and it's like, well, that's done.
Yeah, especially so, if it's something you don't like.
Yeah, if they've got like the wrong shoes with it, I'm like, I'm not wearing this now because I saw somebody wearing it with like such and such, so... You know, it just kind of puts you off as well.
Yeah. Those things you see in the paper, like, not in the paper, on the internet, that's how old I am, on the paper, who wore it better and they've got two people wearing the same outfit. So, you know, why?
Yeah. And then, also like on the internet as well, seeing like internet shopping fails.
Oh, that's hilarious.
Yeah. And it's like this beautiful, like, silk organza dress that's nice and like voluminous and floaty, and then they get it and it's just like there's like nothing for quality, and yeah.
Oh, yeah, I know, they're disastrous, aren't they? Well, you wouldn't get that if you can't afford it, do you?
No, you wouldn't.
Hey, lovely talking to you.
Oh, you too.
And
yeah, it's always a pleasure.
And we'd like to come back and talk to you again.
Yes.
Cool.
Perfect.